Here we have the Earth. I've also got the Moon, not to scale, should be bigger. And you're going to play the role of the Sun, also not to scale, should be less bright. No, you stop it. So from your point of view, as the Sun, every now and then you will see the Moon move in front of the Earth because all the orbits have lined up and we get an eclipse. And because if you view the solar system from above, looking down onto the North Pole, the dominant angular momentum is anti-clockwise. So the Moon goes anti-clockwise around the Earth when viewed from above. And that means, from the Sun's point of view, the Moon always goes from your left over to your right. So the shadow, from the point of view of anyone on the Earth, always goes from the west to the east. Except, because of a quirk of geometry, at the very top of the Earth and the very bottom of the Earth, you occasionally get an eclipse which goes the wrong way. It goes from east to west. But the only way I could see one of these incredibly rare reverse eclipses would be to go to Antarctica. So I came to Antarctica. The South Pole is just to the south of here, and I should mention that this video is brought to you by brilliant.org/standupmaths, because the logo looks a bit like a globe, and I'm about here. I can show you why the poles are particularly interesting for a solar eclipse using this cheap inflatable globe I've brought with me and attached to a lanyard that's attached to me, because if this blows overboard, I mean, littering is bad at the best of times, but I think in Antarctica, I would be in violation of a minimum of one international treaty. So this is firmly attached to me. And fun fact, because of the ship I'm on, I would be tried in a court in Norway. There you go. Anyway, more about this ship and its incredible hybrid engine in other videos, and there are details in the description. We're going to have a look at what happens if we have an eclipse near the pole. And if the Earth orbited, or rather, you know, rotated like this, directly up and down compared to the solar plane. So I'm using the Sun as the Sun. So if it was flat with the Sun, nothing special. But because it's a bit like the brilliant.org/standupmaths logo and it tilts back, the light from the Sun hits a whole region around the bottom of the planet. So if I get the Moon again, which is not attached to me, so this video may one day be used as evidence. Anyway, so as the Moon comes across, again, always going left to right from the Sun's point of view, here comes the shadow across the Earth. And of course, it's going from west to the east. Now, if we tilt back, it could go left to right on the other side of the pole. It's still doing left to right. That's not going to change. The Moon always orbits the same way around. However, because humans came up with east and west, that flips on the other side. So down here, it's going still left to right, but the shadow, it was going this way, which is over here, east to west. So you only get an east to west eclipse if it's on, like the Moon is projecting onto the far side of one of the poles. And so that's why I've had to come all the way down here.
Here we have the excellent eclipse path viewer from timeanddate.com, and you can see it does go straight across Antarctica, although not this way up. So the Earth will be in this orientation at the time, with this right at the bottom. And actually, these weird curved paths should form, I think, a straight line if I get this right down. Like, so your point of view watching the video is the Sun, and there's the shadow is going to sweep across here, left to right, whoom. And then these are the bands depending on how much of the umbra shadow you get. Who cares about this? We want to be in this line here, and it goes left to right this way. And so from our point of view, it's going to be going from over here in the east to the west. I know I keep repeating this, I'm very excited. However, I thought you might like to know, and it'll help me justify this being a whole video, it's not the only interesting bit of math that happens at the poles.
The other interesting thing about the poles is the Antarctic, and indeed the Arctic circles, which this globe manufacturer has not bothered to put on. So they've put on these, your lines of latitude, which are just a creation of humans. There's nothing innately, you know, 360-degreeness about the Earth. The fact that we go 10 360ths for each line is just, it's arbitrary. There's nothing 360 about the Earth. That's just an arbitrary number that humans pick. So these lines have no, you know, innate link to the Earth, whereas the Antarctic Circle does. It's maths time. All right, let me draw in the Earth in cross section as a big old circle. And then over here, let's pop in some rays coming from the sun. I'm drawing them all parallel. Yes, technically they're not parallel, but the sun is so far away, it doesn't make a difference. I mean, if you really, really wanted to, I could draw in the kind of the sun-Earth line or plane, which goes right through there. And then we've got the perpendicular direction from that. But the Earth does not rotate on that perpendicular axis. Some planets do. Venus, Jupiter, I think. The Earth rotates along this axis here. So it's just a little bit off. And that angle in there, that is 23.5 degrees. That is the tilt of the Earth. Now, the Antarctic Circle, or rather disk, or cap. It's, you know, it's the part of the Earth where it's possible to have 24-hour daylight. And I don't mean to labor this point, but just a quick recap. It's daytime if you're standing on the side of the Earth facing the sun. And then as the Earth orbits, you end up on the other side. And then you're standing in the dark and it's nighttime. So we need somewhere on the Earth where even if you go all the way around the back during the Earth's rotation, you still stay in the sunshine. So let's say it's over here for argument's sake. It's daytime, sun's hitting you. You then rotate all the way around and now it's nighttime and you're over here. However, these rays coming from the sun can still hit you. So despite the fact it's the middle of the night, you're as far away as you can get in the Earth's rotation, it's still daylight. And that's the extreme. Anywhere inside that circle, this will work. And now you think, well, where is that? So this point here is just the lowest point. It's the bit at the bottom compared to the planetary plane. And so that angle in there, well, it's opposite. These are two straight lines and it's opposite the one over here. So that angle there is 23.5 degrees. And likewise, at the time of the year I've drawn this diagram in, you'll have the Arctic Circle at the top there. And they are all the places where it's possible to have 24-hour darkness, where you get 24-hour night. So it turns out the Arctic and the Antarctic circles are just the tilt of the Earth. Actually, maybe I was a bit mean about the globe makers, because they have put on the Tropic of Capricorn, which is this dotted line here. They have put on the Tropic of Cancer up here. And of course, we've got the equator. And so they are the three other lines, which are not an artificial creation of humans, but rather were given to us by extraterrestrial means. Oh, that's a great clickbait title. Oh, I should have called the video that. Anyway, to have a look at how the tilt of the Earth means that we get the tropics, well, we're going to have to go to the tropics. I said, we're going to have to go to the tropics. Ah, I wish that worked. It's really cold here. Right. Tropics are all the places where it's possible to have the sun directly overhead. At some point in the year, the sun is directly above you. So for me right now, it's quite low because it's pretty much nighttime and I'm in Antarctica. So I came to Antarctica. But to be directly above, we're saying it's like at right angles, it's like the normal to the surface of the Earth where you happen to be. So it means we need somewhere, if you look straight up, you see the sun, which is going to be here, straight down the sun-Earth line. So I know I said the rays from the sun are parallel, but it means if you're hypothetically over here somewhere, looking straight up, then the rays of the light aren't coming straight down on you. This is the only point over here where it works. So where is that point? Well, we can draw in the equator, which we haven't needed until now, which is at right angles to the axis of rotation. So we draw it in like here, that's our equator. And that is defined by just the rotation of the Earth. Humans didn't decide that. We got that one for free. And now we need to know what angle down here you can go and see that there. But of course, during the Earth's orbit, like that axis stays still as it goes around like this. And so actually you can be anywhere that far below, or you could have been that far above up there. And so that angle there, the distance down from the equator to get to one tropic and up to get to the other one, well, it's the same angle. It's 23.5 5 degrees. So it turns out the tropics are just the tilt of the Earth. It's all the tilt of the Earth.
Well, I say it's all the tilt of the Earth, but that's relative to the rotational axis of the Earth. And the rotational pole is not the only pole.
There's also the magnetic pole, and the South Magnetic Pole is currently that way. I checked my compass a second ago, and throughout this trip, I have constantly been saying that the South Pole is just to the south of here, as my wife, Professor Lucie, can confirm.
He has.
Excellent, because I think it's pretty funny. Also, strictly correct, both the rotational axis South Pole and the magnetic South Pole are in the same direction from this side of Antarctica. But the magnetic pole, that's just one of the many physical properties that manifest themselves because the Earth is made of certain materials and is spinning a certain way, like the fact it's an oblate spheroid, and it drifts because magnetic fields are complicated, as my wife, Professor Lucie Green, can confirm.
They are, I love them, but I prefer the sun's magnetic
pole. Oh, you do? Which is more complicated?
More complicated and more dynamic.
And more interesting, Lucie would say. So yeah, so magnetic fields are not as straightforward as just a rotational axis. And at the moment, the South Magnetic Field doesn't even have the decency to be inside the Antarctic Circle. It's actually just outside the landmass and the Antarctic Circle of Antarctica. And it's moving away at on the order of 5 kilometers a year. So they are both in that direction, but if I was on the other side of Antarctica, I could be between them. So then the South Pole would be to the south of me, but the South Pole magnetic would also be to the north of me, but my compass would say that it was to the south of me. It's ridiculous. Thank goodness the Antarctic Circle is nice and reliable. Unfortunately, it's not that simple. We have the Milankovitch cycles to worry about. Well, most of them we can ignore. They're things like the orbit of the Earth around the sun changes slightly. It's also precessing. So if you put it on a 23.5 degree angle, it's doing this, like a spinning top. I mean, it's literally a spinning top. So it's going around like this, but all that does is change where the seasons are in the also changing orbit. What we care about is the very slight wobble. So if we put it on its 23.5 degree tilt like this, it's also doing a very slight wobble. In fact, the angle is going between 22.1 degrees and 24.5. So it's a bit over 2 degrees of variation. And that changes how it interacts with the sun. I mean, that is not responsible for climate change at all, because I mean, the scales are totally different. That's like, you know, blaming, glacial movement for kicking a football, right? The time scales and the rates of change are totally out. But on very long time scales, it does make a very slight difference. Currently, the Earth is getting straighter, so it's tipping back up, which means that the Antarctic Circle is getting smaller. So as well as the ice melting, which don't worry, will be its whole own other video, it's also, I think, I just heard some ice crack and fall off right then. Oh, I hope that was in the background. Probably wasn't. I can't see the water moving, but there you are, melting as we speak, different video. Separate to that, the Antarctic Circle itself is shrinking. Which is a long way to say weird things happen at the poles, and that's why we're here to see a solar eclipse going in the wrong direction, and surely the solar eclipse day will be as sunny as this.
Nope, cloudy. We got up at just after 3 a.m. to watch the beginning of the partial phase, which was happening roughly here. As we neared the point of totality at just after 4 a.m., we decided to go and join the busiest part of the ship, where loads of passengers and members of staff were looking confused, staring at grey clouds.
So Lucie, can you point out where the sun is right now?
Apparently, yeah. It's over there.
And how far through the eclipse are we?
We're just over halfway through that first bit of the partial phase. So We've got about 10 minutes to go until totality.
Oh, 10 minutes? Yeah. That explains the air of excitement. Okay, Lucie, can we see the sun?
No.
No. Can we see the horizon?
No.
But is it getting noticeably darker?
It's really, really dark.
That.
This is like the most night I felt in the whole trip.
This is the darkest we've had in weeks. I think technically, Lucie, we're in an eclipse right now.
Again.
Again.
Hey, and it goes. Hey, what a moon. Good job.
So that was the eclipse. The sun is still somewhere behind that fog and cloud. It was light, it got dark, it's light again. I got a free eclipse viewer to add to my collection.
So there you are, all the way to the Antarctic for this. Which means, of all the clouds I've ever seen, these ones are the most expensive.
But the important thing is that I got to see an eclipse going the wrong way. And for that, I am deeply pleased. And I'm very glad that I filmed the sponsor message back when it was sunny. You don't have to go to the ends of the earth to learn maths and science. You can use the sponsor of this video, brilliant.org/standupmaths. They have lessons where you can learn all sorts of science, maths, programming, logic, you name it. In fact, they've got a course where you calculate the gravitational field for a shell-shaped planet. That's pretty exciting. Not dissimilar to what we were doing here with eclipses. And they've got one where you calculate the gravitational field if you were on a flat Earth. Well, I say if. Just yesterday we had a tour of the edge. It's just... We're not! Oh! Well, that's all. And given it is the festive snowy season, if you would like to give an annual premium membership to brilliant.org/standupmaths and use my referral code, you'll get 20% off the first 200 people. So there you are. Give the gift of learning this festive season.